This year, we began by preaching on baggage, needing to unload some things. We talked about the clash of the titans. We talked about the enemy's last ditch effort. We talked about God's on the move again. We talked about turning the tables on your enemy, Esther, Mordecai, and Haman. As I went back and looked at the messages, I saw this thread that God is wanting to move again in America. And the church has to unpack some luggage. The church needs to reform itself, get positioned for the next move of God. And because of this, the enemy is trying so hard to discourage the people of God and to get them to quit at the last minute. So he's put up his last ditch effort. He's released the spirit of Jezebel in the land. Leviathan is on the move. I can hear his tail switching around me. We see that twisting spirit, lies, deception. Christians are battling a spirit of witchcraft. Words, thoughts flying. But through all of this, I find great hope. Because the Bible says that he knows his time is short. And so he's angry. He's angry this morning. I can tell. He's mad. He knows his time is short. And we're in the 12th month of the religious calendar, the Hebraic calendar, the 12th month, Adar. And Adar, being that last month, for the Jew, is a month of alignment. The planets come into alignment, lunar, solar calendar. The 12th month, things are coming into alignment. 12 being that number of government structure. Things are coming into alignment. It's a month for them of change. They're going to change some things, change it. And they're getting ready for Passover. And the enemy knows this. He senses it. It's like Numbers 13, Israel as Kadesh Barnea getting ready to cross over the River Jordan to possess their land. Where they're right at Passover. But the 12 spies go out, they come back, 2 with a good report, 10 with a bad one. And Leviathan gets involved, and he twists things. He starts turning things, and fear gets into the people. And suddenly, a grasshopper mentality grips the nation. And we understand that grasshopper mentalities never possess giant-sized promises. And so they're turned back to wander in a wilderness for 40 years, all because of Leviathan twisting. Right at that point of transition. And here we are in the month of Adar, facing our Kadesh Barnea, facing a time of crossing over. And Leviathan's at work to try to discourage people, to twist the nation, to mess things up, to pit people against one another, deception, lies. And it's at work today. You can feel his tail of that crocodile. Leviathan, he's switching his tail. You can tell he's at work. This is a pivotal moment. The month of Adar is a month that contains a time link. And stay with me here. It's a time link because you remember the scripture in Esther 4, yet who knows whether you, Esther, have been brought to the kingdom for such a time link as this. Esther was that transition point. She transitioned the Jews from being victims to being victors. She was like John the Baptist. She pulled two seasons together. It was a powerful time. It was a powerful moment, and Esther was a key player. You see, that word time in the Hebrew speaks of a season. It talks about, notice this, past time, future time, a continuous existence. Do you see the time link? Past time, future time, Esther right in the middle, a continuous existence. You see it with the 12 spies. Those 12 spies had an opportunity to be a time link between what Israel was and what Israel could be, from being in the wilderness to being in the land of promises. But those 10 guys blew their moment. And I've always had this concern that I could come to such a time as this and I could miss my moment. That somehow I wasn't paying attention. That somehow I didn't have the courage, the strength to step up, to put my life on the line as Esther did. If I perish, I perish, but I go before the king. A time link. And here we are in this month of Adar. And I know we have to be careful. I get that. You know, you get caught up in numbers and this and that and symbols and metaphors. And some people get real squirrely with it. You don't have to look at, you know, the Hebrew calendar to decide what type of detergent you're going to buy at the store. I get all that. Extremes. I get it. But I know that God honors times and seasons. I expect on the day of Pentecost for Holy Spirit to fall. I just do. I expect things to happen at Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, or Atonement, at Tabernacles. I expect things to happen. It's the Feast of the Lord, and He honors those seasons. I expect in the month of Adar things to happen. I expect things to fall into alignment in my life. I expect change to happen. I expect that I'm at that point of transition, and I'm getting ready for passing over, and I don't want to miss my moment. And the enemy is fighting hard, hard. I made this statement to you. He knows his time is short. And so the longer you stand, the madder he gets. The madder he gets. And he's escalating. He's escalating. He's pushing that red button. He's ramping it up. I can sense it. I can feel the spirit of Leviathan. I can feel Jezebel sending out her words of witchcraft. I can sense Medusa trying to turn the hearts of God's people to stone when we give up and we quit. Clash of the Titans. We see how this year has unfolded. And here we are today. And I just believe that the enemy has pulled another trick out of his bag. Holy Spirit's been stirring in me and revealing the enemy and what he's doing. How many believes we're not ignorant of his devices and schemes and strategy? How many knows that with revelation there comes freedom? So today is a day to be encouraged. It's a day to declare freedom, deliverance for God's people. It's the day. It's the day for that. And so I want to take you to 1 Chronicles chapter 14, verses 8 through 17. Now, while you're turning, let me tell you that I've got to take two stories and merge them together and do all of this in a timely fashion. So bear with me today. 1 Chronicles 14, verse 8. Now, when the Philistines heard that David had been anointed king over Israel, all the Philistines went up to search for David, and David heard of it, and he went out against them. Then the Philistines went up, and notice this, made a raid on the valley of Rephaim. David inquired of God, saying, "Shall I go up against the Philistines? Will you deliver them into my hand?" The Lord said, "Yes, go up, for I will deliver them." So they went to Baal Perazim, or Lord Perazim, and David defeated them. Then David said, "God has broken through." Notice this. God has broken through my enemies by my hand like a breakthrough of water. Breakthrough of water. Therefore, they called the name of that place Baal Perazim. And when they left their gods there, notice this, they dropped their gods. David gave a commandment that they should burn them. Then the Philistines once again made a raid on the valley. Therefore, David inquired again of God. God said to him, "You shall go up after them, but this time circle around them, come up from behind the mulberry trees, and it shall be when you hear a sound of marching in the top of the trees, then you shall go out to battle, for God has gone out before you this time. God's gone out before you to strike the camp of the Philistines." So David did as God commanded him. They drove back the army of the Philistines. Then the name of David went out into all the land, and the Lord brought the fear of him upon all nations. I want you to notice a key verse. But I want to read it to you in the Message Bible. David attacked at Baal-perazim and slaughtered them. David said, God exploded my enemies as water explodes from a burst pipe. That's how the place got its name, Baal-perazim. Baal explosion. Let's title this today, The Ghost of Old Giants. Pray with me. Father, we pray for the anointing to be upon the reading of your word and the words that I share today. As always, Holy Spirit, take me by the hand and walk me through this. Help me to communicate effectively to the people of God what you put in my spirit. And may freedom ring in the house today. May there be hope and encouragement. May we realize that the enemy's only mad and he's only intensified his efforts because he knows his time is short. I pray it in Jesus' name. And the church said amen and amen. Okay. Let me just take a moment just to remind everyone that we need to set things in order. 1 Chronicles 15, verse 13. Okay. Now we're in 1 Chronicles 14 right now, but the very next chapter, 15, it reads, for because you did not do the first time the Lord our God broke out against us, because we did not consult him about the proper order. Now you know the story. David tries to bring the ark back to Jerusalem, but instead of following the order of the Lord and carrying on the shoulders of the Levites, they carried it on a new cart. They picked up a worldly method from the Philistines. They copied the world. How many knows you can't do church the way the world does? Okay. So, God broke out. You remember at the threshing floor. He reaches out and touches the ark. The man falls dead. God broke out, the Bible said. Perazim broke out because Israel did not follow order. You see, guys, this is something we need. I can't preach on this. Oh, we could stay here for a while. But I want you to hear this. You need to know that disorder causes collateral damage. When we break order in the house of God, when we break order in our own family, when we break protocol, when everything isn't done decently and in order, when we don't understand spiritual authority or authority in the home or authority in the government, whenever we break protocol, whenever we break order, there's always collateral damage. You see, I worry about that because people, you know, people will step into moments and they'll break order, they'll break rank, they'll pull out of the lines. And when they do, they don't realize it, but somebody else is going to get hurt. Somebody may die because we did not follow order. So they didn't follow order, and so he dies. He touches, Uzzah touches the ark and he dies. The second thing I want you to notice, though, this is chapter 13 where they broke order, okay? And chapter 14, now the Philistines seek to destroy David. But you see, David equated success with prayer. The first time he went to God and said, do you want me to fight the Philistines? God said, absolutely. Then the second time when they came back, it would have been tempting to assume that God wants me to fight them again. But David equated success with prayer, and he learned to never move without God first talking to him. And so David goes back the second time and says, do you want me to fight the Philistines? And God says, yes, I do. But this time, instead of going head on, I want you to go around the back door. And when you hear the shuffling of my feet in the top of the trees, you know it's then. And God went before David and fought the battle for him. So David equates success with prayer in chapter 14. And then in chapter 15, he's got it right now. Chapter 13, they messed it up. They didn't follow order. And chapter 14, he says, I'm going to talk to God before I do anything. And then in chapter 15, they put the ark on the shoulders of the Levites. And when David humbles himself, God shoulders the load. Listen to that. When David humbled himself and did it God's way, God shouldered the load. Because it says there in that chapter that whenever the Levites put their shoulders underneath that pole, the Bible says that God helped them. And many of the Jews and historical writings believe that there was a supernatural assistance to pick up that ark that weighed, some believe, 1,000 pounds. And those men were able to carry the ark with supernatural assistance. Think of that. When they humbled themselves, God shouldered the load. When we humble ourselves, God shoulders the load. We men have a tendency to want to carry the load. But when we let go of it and we humble ourselves and we go down through the eye of the needle, unload the back first and then humble yourself and go through the eye of the needle, put God first, then suddenly God shoulders the load. God carries it for us. And here's a statement for you I want you to get. Brokenness attracts strength. Guys, you want to be strong? Then be broken. Brokenness will attract strength. And so I just want you to see how this thing of order was so important. In chapter 13, they broke protocol. Someone dies. In chapter 14, David says, I'm going to talk to God before I do anything. And then in chapter 15, God says, now, because you've humbled yourself, I am going to help you, and I will carry the load. And everybody said amen. Okay, so we got order set. So now, let's go back to our story here in chapter 14, okay? I want to talk to you about the valley of old giants. Now, this is something that I've never seen before, okay? God began to deal with me, and I started digging, and I found this, okay? Let me talk to you about a minute's notice. In our text, in verse 8, it says, the minute the Philistines heard that David had been made king over a united Israel, and that's important, you got to notice that, united Israel, they went out in force to capture David. You see, whenever the Philistines heard that David, who they knew David, they knew who he was. He's the shepherd boy that's anointed king who Saul tries to kill, Saul's jealous of, the nation is divided. They know who he is, so they know the story. And the minute they heard that he was made king over a united Israel, Judah and Israel come together, one nation, they went out to kill him. They wanted to deal with him. You see, they knew who he was. He's the red-headed stepchild of Jesse. Now, you remember the message I preached here a few years ago on the red-headed stepchild. 8 boys, David's the 8th. In the Talmud, the historical writings of the Jews, they believe that David was perceived as a stepchild, red-headed stepchild. Red-headed stepchild, because the Bible says he was ruddy in appearance. The word ruddy, it means like a red complexion, red hair. He was ruddy. He had a fair complexion. He was pleasant to look at, but he was just a boy. And so there were those who believed that he was a redheaded stepchild. And that's why whenever Samuel came to Jesse's house, Jesse never presented him. He brought out them 7 boys, and Samuel looked him over and said, nope, you got anything else? He says, well, I've got this other boy out keeping the sheep. Go get him. And he was the one. And so you see, these Philistines knew this. They knew what David had been through, the rejection. Okay? Eating at a table by himself while Jesse and them other boys ate at the family table. Psalms, you set a table for me in the presence of my enemies. You see, he was considered to be illegitimate. Psalms, in sin did my mother conceive me. So you see, David is considered this red-headed stepchild, illegitimate. And so the Philistines know this, and so they're going to come after David. They're going to come after him in a minute's notice, in a minute's notice. Did you know that people will forgive you for anything except success? The minute he was made king, the minute he was anointed, hell got mad. The minute God begins to promote you, people will get upset. You see, people will define you by where you've been instead of where you're going. You see, the problem is once people meet you as an alcoholic, you're always an alcoholic. Once people meet you as an adulterer, you're always an adulterer. Once people meet you, okay, in a problem, they always identify you with the problem. So people have a tendency to define you by where you've been instead of where you're going, even though God calls things that are not as though they are. Even though you're Abram, you have no children, they'll always see you as fatherless, but God will call you Abraham, father of many nations, before Isaac is ever born. That's just people. That's just the way they are, and I get that. So repeat this after me. My history is not my destiny. You got to get that in your head right now, because there are some of you out there right now that you're being held captive by your history. You want to step into your destiny. You want to be Abraham, but you don't have any boys running around the camp. And it's hard for you to let go of the past to embrace the future. It's hard for you to step out of the old identity and to step in the new identity. It's hard for you to let go of who you were to become who you are. We're not going to get stuck. But in a minute's notice, hell will rise up. Let me tell you something. I've said this to you many times. I never knew there was a devil until I started serving God. I never knew the imps of hell until I really got anointed and started. Listen, let me tell you something. The thicker the anointing gets on me, the more hell fights me. The Bible says when he was anointed king, boom, in a minute's notice, here comes hell. Hell does not want you to step into your destiny. The second thing I want you to see here is in verse 9, talking about awakening the ghost of old giants. You see, it says on their way to what? To find David. On their way to find David, the Philistines stopped off to plunder the Valley of Rephaim. I said, what? Why would you do that? Because the word Rephaim means to invigorate a giant, an old tribe of giants. Guys, put it on the screen. It means ghost. Look at that. This valley where they stopped off to pick up some things means invigorating a giant. Old tribe of giants. It's called in some places the Valley of Giants. It refers in another place, that same Hebrew word in another place in Psalms means ghost. Talks about the dead, old ancestors, dead. And this is what they were doing. You see, as I mentioned in 1 Samuel 16, whenever Samuel came to anoint David, the Bible says he was a ruddy boy, just red complexion, red-headed stepchild. Redheaded, reddish complexion, a person or thing that is neglected, unwanted, or mistreated. And they knew that this was in David. They knew that. It was down in David. It was there. It was there. 1 Samuel 17 says, when the Philistines looked about and saw David, he disdained him, for he was only a youth, ruddy and good-looking. Talking about Goliath. Goliath, the champion of the Philistines, and 1 Samuel 17, when he looked about and saw David, he thought, well, this is just a boy. He's just reddish complexion, good-looking kid. You see, the Philistines knew who he was. So when the Philistines got ready to go fight David, now that he's anointed king, okay, everything up to this point hasn't worked. Division in the nation. Saul throwing spears. Goliath couldn't kill him. And on, they couldn't stop him. Hell tried, so many tried to hide him from Samuel. Keep him out back. Don't show him to Samuel, Jesse. They did everything they could to stop that boy. If you read the life of David, you see that hell has done everything it can to prevent David from stepping into his destiny, to keep him from getting anointed king. So what happens now is once he's anointed, okay, we couldn't hide him. Goliath couldn't kill him. Saul couldn't kill him. We couldn't stop him. Okay, now he's king. What are we going to do? Let's stop by the Valley of Rephaim and let's awaken the ghost of some old giants. Old giants. You see, the Philistines tried to awaken an old giant, what is now a new king. So they wanted to go back to resurrect them old feelings and to remind David, listen, you're just that redheaded stepchild. You're illegitimate. You're not a real bona fide son of Jesse. You know, Jesse never did believe in you. In sin did your mother conceive you. You know, you're nobody. You're half the man of Saul. You're just a boy. You pale in comparison to a real champion like Goliath. You're nobody. You're just a shepherd boy. You don't amount to anything. So they were trying to awaken the ghost of old giants. You know, the enemy does that. The enemy does that. It does that. There's times in your ministry when a mantle falls on you and there's anointing that comes on you and there's an opportunity that's presented to you. And suddenly, as you're getting ready to step into that opportunity, the enemy comes along and he awakens the ghost of old giants. Insecurities. And he'll begin to tell you, you can't. They won't. God never will. Awaken the ghost of old giants. Things that we struggled with in our past. Things that we dealt with. And suddenly now he tries to awaken them. He tries to resurrect them to remind you, you're nothing. You're nobody. You can't do this. You know who you are. You know where you came from. You came from on the other side of the tracks. You know what your past is. I know what you did. I know who you are. And he'll do that. He'll resurrect the ghost of old giants. And there are people in here this morning and people watching on the web that right now, the month of Adar, we're right here, alignment, change. We're getting ready for Passover. God's trying so hard to move in America, and the church has got to be ready, and we're trying to transition, and we're trying to move, and we're trying to push forward, and the enemy has tried everything to keep us from this moment, and nothing so far has worked. He's thrown some spears. We faced some giants. We fought some battles. It's been tough. So he's got one last trick to resurrect the ghost of old giants. To remind us, as David came out on that battlefield that day and he faced Goliath, who some believe was over 9 feet tall, the Bible says Goliath looked down at him and said, "You're just a boy." And why did he use that word ruddy? You're just a ruddy boy. That word triggered something in David's mind. You're a redheaded stepchild. You're illegitimate. Jesse never did embrace you. Jesse never put his approval on you. Jesse never did recognize you as his boy. You're nobody. You have no history. You have no future. You're nothing. You're just a shepherd boy. How dare you come out here to challenge me? In that moment, David felt that giant looming over him. But more than the size of the man was the shadow of his past. Just a ruddy boy, nobody. And in that moment, David was faced with a decision. Do I give in to the fear? Do I give in to the doubt? Do I give in to the second guessing myself? This condemnation, do I give in to it? Or do I take what God has given me? Just a rag and a rock. And David makes a decision to not be defined by his past, but to be defined by his future. And he took what God had given him and he gave it to the enemy. And God got behind it. And he defeated his enemy. You see, the enemy wants to awaken the ghost of old giants. Old giants. So David is standing here in the Valley of Rephaim. The Philistines come out. And they want to remind him, you're just a ruddy boy and you have no right to be king. Who do you think you are? But this is the most defining battle of his life. This thing with Goliath, this thing that he's facing, this ruddiness, it's a defining battle. It's a defining battle. You see, this was a moment for David. David was facing his Goliath. You see, Goliath was everything that David wanted to be. Now when I say Goliath, I want you to see more than just a 9-foot man. I want you to see his past, okay? He's facing his past. That's what he's facing. Because Goliath was everything that David wanted to be. Because the name Goliath means splendor. He was tall. He was big. He was a champion. The whole army believed in Goliath. They were behind him. David was just a boy, ruddy boy. And Goliath was everything that he wanted to be. And David needed to kill this giant. But more than just killing Goliath, he needed to kill his past. He needed to put a rock in the forehead of his past that said, you're ruddy, you're a stepchild, you're illegitimate, Jesse doesn't believe in you, your brothers don't believe in you. Remember, when he shows up to the battle line, he came to bring him a lunch, and his own brother said, what are you doing here? Why aren't you back there tending the sheep? You're nothing but a stable boy. Get yourself home. You don't have no right to be here. And yet, David is on the battlefield. And in this moment, he is facing not only the giant in front of him, but the giant of his past. And I've come here this morning to ask a very simple question to God's people. Do you have a giant that needs to be killed? Do you have a past that you need to kill? Do you have a past that you need to deal with? Do you have a past that you need to put a rock in its forehead? Do you have a Goliath? Because understand this, this could be your defining battle. Did you know that many Christians are held back by one thing? Not several, not many, one thing. One experience, one childhood experience, one major mistake. One statement that was said to them, you're stupid, you'll never amount to anything. One statement can get in your spirit. One statement can be released by the words of Jezebel. Witchcraft can get on it and it can twist you up to where it'll mess you up for the rest of your life. Think about it. Is there a giant in your past? Is there an insecurity? Is there a fear? Is there a mistake? Is there a childhood experience? Is there something in your past that you need to kill? Because when David was there facing his Goliath, I know that boy, when he said he's ruddy, I know that boy stood there and he heard the words of Jesse and them boys and never believed in him. And in this moment, he'll either deal with his past or his past will deal with him. Think about it. Do you have a giant that needs to be killed? You see, your biggest giant can become your biggest blessing. How do I know this? Because 1 Samuel 17:25, the man who kills him, speaking of Goliath, the king will enrich with great riches, will give him his daughter and give his father's house exemption from taxes in Israel. That's what they said to David. They said, look, if you go out there and kill that boy, think about it. You get rich, you get the king's daughter, and you live tax-free for the rest of your life. David said, what a deal. I would have asked first to see the daughter, but I'm joking. David already knew her. So here's the statement for you. Again, your biggest giant can be your biggest blessing. Here's another one for you. Your blessing is in your battle. Have you ever gone through a battle? Have you ever been in a battle where you wanted to quit? Have you ever been in a battle where you just wanted to throw up your hands and walk away? Don't do it. Because in your battle, you'll find your blessing. In the fight that you're in right now, there's a blessing. What doesn't break you makes you better. There's a blessing in your battle. There's a fight. There's a fight. And I know it. And I get it. And when you're out there on the battlefield and you're facing Goliath, not only the giant, but the Goliath of your past. When you're facing this, and everything in you says, drop the leather rag and run. Just go back to tending the sheep, writing music. Let them other boys deal with this. You're facing this thing. In the midst of this, the pressure is so great. But it's then that you have to remind yourself, my biggest battle can be my biggest blessing. If I can come through this, my blessing's in my battle. In this battle, there's a blessing. I know it. If I can just take his head, I get the riches, I get the girl, and I get tax exemption. If I just hang in here, I can do this. I can do this. And you see, Holy Spirit has been dealing with me. He's been whispering in my spirit. The enemy is trying to awaken the ghost of old giants. He's trying to awaken the ghost of old giants. He's coming to God's people right now, and he's saying, okay, I couldn't stop you with Jesse. I couldn't stop you with Goliath. I couldn't stop you with Saul. So I'm going to drop by the Valley of Rephaim, and I'm going to pull up the ghost of some old giants, and I'm going to remind you, David, that you're just a redheaded stepboy. Trying to awaken things. He's trying to awaken insecurities in God's people. He's trying to awaken things that we struggled with, strongholds, things that we fought years ago. He's trying to awaken those things and say, you can't, people won't, God never will. These insecurities that we all deal with, he's trying to awaken, as the word Rephaim means, invigorating a giant, old tribe of giants, ghost. He's trying to invigorate some old strongholds, invigorate some old fears, invigorate some old insecurities. He's trying to awaken the ghost of old giants to keep God's people from moving forward. And this is your defining battle. If you can whip this one thing, what is it for you? We find this in the Gospel of Mark. Jesus is confronted by a young rich ruler and says, what must I do to step into the kingdom? And Jesus said, one thing you're lacking. Just one thing. One thing. Not two things. Not three things. One thing. He said, if you'll take care of that one giant in your life, which was the love of money, he says, you can follow me. And the Bible says this young rich ruler walked away saddened because he was possessed by his riches. And the sad thing about this story, the sad thing is that we know who the 12 are. We have their names. But we don't know that boy's name. We never learned it. We never learned it because he couldn't deal with his one thing. Think if he had dealt with that one thing, where would he be today? He would be recorded in the Word of God. But we never got it. We never got his name. You see, what's the one thing? What's the one thing for you? What is the one thing that stands between you, your children, and your children's children, and the treasures of heaven? What must I do to inherit eternal life? What must I do to step into the treasures? What must I do, Jesus? Just one thing, son. Deal with your one thing, and the treasures of heaven are yours. And he missed it. Think about that. Think what happened with David. David on the battlefield, facing his Goliath, reminded of his past. Suddenly, fear, insecurities rise up within him. But he overcomes, and because David overcomes his fear, his insecurity, deals with this giant, look what happens to his lineage. Listen, guys, I've told you this before. You're fighting not only for your life, but the life of your children's children. We have to think generational. If I stay on track, my children will be blessed. If I get off track, what does that do to them? We have to think this way. So I'm asking you this morning, guys, is there a giant that you need to kill? Is there something in your past that you need to deal with? It's important because the victory over Goliath changes everything. It changes everything. Everything. It changes everything. Everything changes when you deal with Goliath. Now, I'm out of time. So, David, come help me. I'm going to give you my last point. We'll be done. I want you to go back to my first point, setting things in order. Chapter 13, 1 Chronicles, David breaks order, and someone dies. Chapter 14, he humbles himself, and he learns to pray. Chapter 15, God says, now because you've humbled yourself, I will shoulder the load. In chapter 14, the Bible says that this was a place called Bel Perazim, which means Lord of the Breaks. In verse 11, he described it as God exploded at like water exploding from a pipe. It's like there was a broken place in David, and out of that broken place, God exploded. Thus comes the statement, the place of your brokenness becomes the point of God's breakthrough. Where you're broken, God breaks out. Brokenness. Brokenness precedes a breakthrough. Brokenness precedes a breakthrough. Think about that. David equated prayer with success. Do you want me to fight the Philistines? Yes, I do. Go head on. Second time. Do you want me to fight the Philistines? Son, I got this one. I got this one. I'll be two steps ahead of you. When you hear the shuffling of my feet, the shuffling of my feet, you need to know that I'm moving and you need to move too. The Message Bible, I believe it says that God was two steps ahead of him. Two steps ahead of him. Because he was a man of humility. Humility will attract strength. So here's the thing, guys. I need to ask the question. Is there an old giant standing between me and the next move of God? And remember, David humbled himself and prayed. God said, I'll be two steps ahead of you. I'm going to move. When you hear the shuffling of my feet, you know I'm moving. The man that humbles himself is the man that comes in behind God. God's always two steps ahead of him. The man that humbles himself is a man that can hear the shuffling of God's feet. The man or the woman that humbles himself is a person that gets the word, that has the dream, that sees the vision. The man that humbles himself is the man that's always two steps behind God. And they can hear God shuffling his feet. Because humility attracts strength. It attracts it. It attracts it. So this morning, I'm going to ask you again, is there an old giant standing between you and the move of God? Is there an old habit, addiction, stronghold, mindset, experience? Is there something there? Are you like the young rich ruler of Mark? There's one thing, just one thing. It don't have to be many, just one thing. Is there one old insecurity, one old fear, one old mindset, one old something, something that you just You pushed it to the back and you just never dealt with it. It's that thing, that hurt, that unforgiveness, that experience, that stronghold, that generational curse from grandfather to father to son, daughter. It's that thing. It's in our family. It's in our bloodline. It's in our genetics. I see it. I know it. It hinders me. It's my one thing. Is there something there? You got to deal with it. 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 If you've never dealt with it, you got to deal with it. If you did deal with it, but the enemy tries to resurrect it, you got to put it back again. You got to keep it in its place. You got to deal with it. Because here's the thing, guys. When you're standing before your giant, and your giant is looming over you, and it says, I know who you are. I know where you came from. I know what you did or you didn't do. I know you. When you're standing there, you've got to realize this is a defining moment. A defining moment. And the killing of your Goliath changes everything. Because the Bible says, get this and I'm done. The Bible says that after David knocked Goliath out, took his sword, Goliath's sword, cut his head off, picked up his head, and he stood before Saul with that head. Now listen to me. This is a fact. The Bible says that Saul refused to let David go home to Jesse. David, in that moment, by killing Goliath, it changed everything in his life. In one moment, one defining battle changed everything. And there are people in here this morning or watching on the web, there's a defining battle for you. If you can just get over that bondage, if you can just get over that stronghold, if you can just get over that greed, if you can just get over that anger, if you can just get over this mindset, if you can just get over this past experience, if you can just let go of this, if you can let go of that, if you can just cut the head of your Goliath off, you need to listen to me. It's a defining battle. And as with David, there is no going back. It changes everything. And we are in the month of Adar. We're facing Passover. And it's time to deal with the ghost of old giants. Would you stand with me this morning? Every head bowed, every eye closed. I need direction. So everyone's praying reverently, please. Just pray for Holy Spirit. Just begin to call on Holy Spirit, the presence of God, the glory of God to settle down in this room. Settle down, settle down. Just the glory of God. You're here this morning, and this message has spoken to you. And you say, Pastor, I need to deal with the ghost of an old giant. It's something in my past. It came out of my childhood, my upbringing. You know, my parents passed it down to me. I had a bad experience or something happened to me as a teenager. But there's this thing in my past that every time I take two steps forward, it seems to pull me back. It's an old giant. And you're ready to change everything. A defining moment for you, defining moment. It's like you're ready to break free of this. If that's you this morning, would you just raise your hand so I know you're here? So I'll know that I need to take a moment here. Is there any hands? Hands. Okay. Why don't the prayer team come forward and spread out across the front and help me this morning? want to open this altar for you to come up and just come up and you don't have to tell them what. You can if you want to, but just say, hey, I need you to agree with me. I've got an old giant that I need to deal with. I need to deal with this today. I want to deal with it once and for all. An insecurity, a trait, a stronghold, a mindset, a fear. I want to deal with it today. I'm ready to go forward and just go with God. I didn't see enough hands. So will you let me pray for you real quick? Father, I sense this morning there are those who are hiding. They're afraid. And the enemy hates exposure. And their freedom is found in exposing the works of the devil. So I'm asking you, Holy Spirit, to give them the courage and the strength just to come forward and say, would you help me? I have a giant I need to kill. Father, would you move this morning, and may there be freedom in the house and deliverance for God's people. Help your people today, Father. I prayed in Jesus' name. Holy Spirit, give them the strength. Help them. And everybody said amen. Okay, you raised your hand. You didn't raise your hand. Come on, you need prayer. Come on, this message is for you. Listen, today's a day of freedom. It's the day to kill an old giant. It's the day to deal with the ghost of your past. The ghost of your past. Come on, find a prayer partner. Come on, find somebody to help you. Come on, you raised your hand. You didn't raise your hand. Who cares what people think? Come on. Come on, come on, come on. Today's the day to get free. Get free. Kill the old giant. You need prayer this morning. Come on. If you have to wait, it's okay. Come on. First time guest, thank you for being here today. We appreciate you guys. God bless you. Make your way to the front foyer, the coffee shop. Pick up your gift, your free cup of coffee also. We love you guys. Thank you so much.